two personal things that happened with my experience of love life that made me realize with conviction, with certainty that Hannah Marlon is indeed my best girl. I'd like to begin this, I guess, by saying that I'm not the most outlandish, I'm not the most overt Hannah Marlon fan. I don't have armor, I don't have an Ida bag. But what I do have, and I guess my claim to why I would be a good fan or representative of Hannah Marlon, would be more or less in this presentation. Next slide, please. Explaining why I put those last two lines there. Those are from her introductory track, dun sa ano, Kimi Kobo's Secret. And when I heard that for the first time, I wondered that I asked myself, that is there something interesting about a girl who says that she's great, who says that that she's insignificant, who sees things in broad strokes and sees the other eight girls of Aqua having a role in that cosmic miracle, but then again excludes herself from that narrative. Is there something interesting about my and eventually when throughout my journey I discovered that yes, there is something interesting about the character who tries to exclude herself from beauty, from the chance of from the chance to make history, if you would call it that. So for tonight, I want to talk about two specific events that made me love Hannah Marlon so much. These are real things. This happened to me, and they show the limit between and they show the interface between reality and fiction. And I believe that at least not only for Love Live but also for our lives as well, Hanamaru, Ruby, and all the other characters are as real as we imagine them. So this is the first event I want to talk about.
Yo, Mix.
I studied in the Ateneo, and in Ateneo, oral examinations are a big thing. So this was a photo of me at my oral examination with my professor. We decided to bring our messes because we're allowed to bring props, and someone brought a lapida to her oral exam with her name on. So why not? So my professor asked me this question next. What, in your opinion, is the role of philosophy in the contemporary? And my answer, removing all the abstract stuff, removing all the philosophical stuff that you probably don't want to hear about, is that next. Is that philosophy attempts to expose what is truly beautiful. It took me 8 minutes to explain that, so at the last 2 minutes, I gave my time back to the prof, and my prof asked me next time, who is she, meaning Vanessa Berry, and why did you bring her here? And and after he asked that, I had episode 4 in mind, and again, the abstract details omitted, I said yes. Next slide, please. Next. My answer in a nutshell when my prof asked me that follow-up question was because Hannah Marlon, in her way, taught me the answer that I just gave my prof. If you want to know what happened in that oral exam, I got a perfect score. So,
yo!
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 Yes,
alright, so next slide, please. One thing I do regret not being able to tell in that exam was the fact that I forgot about episode 5. And we know what episode 5 is. It's Yoshiko's debut. We explore the origins of her fallen angel thing. And episode 4 at that time did not come to my mind, but perhaps it should have. Because one point I should have made is that when people fail, our ethical responsibility of exposing and propagating beauty to the world in the same way, in the same stroke, that Hanamaru brought Ruby out so that she can shine. It doesn't only involve the creation of new art. It doesn't just involve showing to the world what it has never seen before. But in a sense, and I find this a bit more beautiful than Ruby's episode, that it also involves seeing beauty in things. Seeing beauty in things from the past, from our past selves, that either by force of circumstance or a pressure of a cruel world, we have forgotten. We see that phenomenon happening with Yohana, because there was a pressure for her to be normal, she decided to drop being the fallen angel thing. But Hanamaru was one of the people who saw behind that and saw the beauty that was in her past. Next.
I love you.
So another instance at which this happened, and Henry would know this because he was in Fukuoka, was when Kim Chan cried at the closing ceremony. It still breaks my heart until now. So this is a tweet from one of the guys who was at the live. I think Andrew knows this
guy. He's
actually a friend. Yes. So Kim Chan was happy to be able to see a lot of people. I guess you can do that next time, please. And in theory, she promised to improve and work hard so that she would be able to get a Hanamaru Center someday because she thought she was failing Hanamaru. I guess this is an important lesson for me because this is actually the first time that I learned something from life. One event similar to Kim Chan crying was back in the first time when Ricky Apple actually broke down playing the piano on day 2. I wrote a long-ass essay about it, but essentially my point is that my point in writing that essay was that when our idols, when anyone for that matter, is subjected to pain, whether it becomes physical or emotional, it becomes hard to let go from the pain. That it becomes hard to see everyone else when you're in pain. Everyone just feels so distant. Rikako felt that she was failing her fans. Kim Chan felt that she was becoming distant from her fans because she still couldn't get to settle. But that itself is something that's hard to transgress. But even if it's hard, their fans eventually is shown support next time. On the day that the guy tweeted it, I had a very long discussion with a lot of other people. I wrote the recap of the episode. I told them that Hanamaru feels the same way that Rikyako and Kinchan experienced the same thing, which is pain, making them feel that they are totally isolated from the rest of the world, and our fans coming back and supporting and expressing in some way, in an attempt to understand or to make their artists understand. In an attempt to make their fans understand that even though we don't truly understand the pain of what it is to fail, we're still behind. Next slide. So here's my synthesis. Both in episode 4 and 5, Hanamaru sees the beautiful, especially the beautiful that we suppress or dismiss as unwanted. And I find this an important lesson because the attitude that Hanamaru holds towards her friends is not only beautiful, but also worthy of emanation of the fan base. The way that Hanamaru sees everyone as capable of sparkling and shining and doing great things, I think that is something that we should see in every girl, not just our best girls. And perhaps it's not just the attitude that we have to move over to the fan base, but in life too. Next time. This is kind of an exercise, but the second part shows that beauty is not always vivid or stunning in grace and goodness, because these are easy to find. More stunningly, it's found where we expect pain and solitude, and when we find beauty in which there is, we normally find pain. So, with that, I end my powerful presentation. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Daryl. Now, I hope you don't mind that we make some adjustments to the program, since we're a bit...